Father, we're so thankful for this day. We're thankful for the opportunity. We're thankful for one another. We're especially thankful for our Saviour. We thank you for the Scriptures. We thank you for the Holy Spirit who works in us, causing us to believe and grow. We pray that as we think about this section, especially to do with witness and living among outsiders, that you would use your word to sharpen our mind, warm our hearts, strengthen our wills, bring you honour and bear lasting fruit. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Some years ago, I spoke at the men's convention. It was a great privilege. I told the story of some soldiers who were doing exercises, which is like battle practice. And I told this ridiculous story of a sergeant major who says to the privates, rifles have been given out. We've run out of some rifles, so not everybody's going to have a rifle. Some of you who have not been given a rifle, you're going to be given a broom handle, but that's going to sort of work the same. If you see anybody, just point the broom handle and say, bangity-bang, bangity-bang, and the person's got to go down. And we've run out of bayonets, so we've got some rulers. We've attached them with rubber bands. If anybody comes up close, just poke them with the ruler and say, stickety-stick, stickety-stick, and the person's got to go down. So there's a guy standing there holding his broom handle with the ruler attached, feeling a bit of an idiot, and it's sort of dusk, and he sees a guy off in the distance, so he calls out, okay, I've seen you, bangity-bang, bangity-bang. The guy doesn't take any notice, just keeps coming towards him. He calls out again, come on, I've seen you, bangity-bang, bangity-bang, you've got to go down. The guy doesn't take any notice, just keeps coming. When he gets up close, he pokes him with the ruler and says, come on, stickety-stick, stickety-stick, down you go. The guy doesn't take any notice, walks right into him, over him, and off into the bushes behind him, saying, tankety-tank, tankety-tank, tankety-tank. I didn't want to tell you that story. I did not want to tell you that story. But we've come to the section to do with warfare, the battle. John 15, verse 18. And I remind you that if you're going to go home today with John 15 in your mind, it begins with the priority of a relationship with Jesus. You and I have got to think about that very carefully. It's a privilege. It's also something that we can nurture. And then we've got to think about loving the other believers. So when you get to church tomorrow and you walk in and you see the guy who's difficult, you've got to be patient and kind. And when you think about the church that you know so well and the minister who you're learning to dislike, you've got to ask the Lord to fill you with great new love for the believers. And now as you turn to 15:18, you'll see Jesus says, if the world hates you. From 17 to 18, from love to hate. So if you're writing something down in your little booklet, the first of the headings is the hatred of the world. And when Jesus talks about the world hating you, this is not the round world. The trees and the grass on the way home will not hate you. The round world in the original Greek language is the little GE from which we get geography. No, the world that Jesus is talking about here is cosmos. It's the system which is profoundly man-centered and very stubbornly man-centered and resistant to the idea that Jesus is at the center of the universe, which he is. So you can imagine, if you present the Christ-centeredness of the universe, there will be some resistance. And this, of course, explains why some Christians and some churches get a lot of opposition and some get a lot of acceptance. Because some explain the Christ-centeredness very clearly and some do not. This explains why some Christians or churches that keep quiet or drop the gospel or change the gospel or teach universalism or preach even man-centered Christianity. Did you know that it's possible to go to a church which is mentioning all the persons of the Trinity, the Bible, heaven and hell, and still be preaching a man-centered universe? It is. This hatred, of course, which Jesus speaks about, is the response of the world that wants to see self at the center to those who are presenting the fact that Christ has been put on the throne of the universe and is the only hope. This hatred, of course, can be very fiery, as it is for some countries, and it can be very icy. The last time I went door knocking with one of the MTS, I never forget this. I'm used to guys opening the door and very reluctantly taking whatever we're giving and saying, get out of here as quickly as you can. But this guy said to us, it is inappropriate that you've stepped onto my property. And the iciness, I think John Piper said some Christians are facing the fires of opposition and some are facing the freeze. I don't know whether there's a freeze where you are, but there's a freeze where I am. Jesus says to his disciples in John 15, I want to prepare you and equip you for this opposition. And so just look with me at the text. Verse 18, he says, you're not the first to be opposed. When Jesus was in the world, he was the visible lightning rod for opposition. Now you and I are in the world, we are a visible lightning rod for the opposition. But the reason is because we represent him and we speak of him and we commend him. You're not the first. Verse 19. You're not really at home here if you've been chosen. Chapter 15, verse 16 says, I've chosen you. You did not choose me, I chose you, and I've appointed you to bear much fruit. Verse 19 says, you're not really at home. You don't quite swim with the secular stream. Your values are different, your speech is different, your presence is different, and that is a challenge. You need to remind yourself. You're not quite at home. Why do you feel so uncomfortable sometimes in this world? Because you've been chosen out of it. And when you've bought your holiday house on the Central Coast or the South Coast, and when you've bought your holiday house overseas, and you think, I can really make my home here, you'll never really feel at home here if you're a Christian. Thirdly, you're unlikely to get better treatment than Jesus, verse 20. Jesus lived, loved perfectly, and was hated. Was he profoundly successful? Well, not in human terms. Was he popular? Not very. I love the fact, incidentally, in Matthew 11, that Jesus has been doing miracles in certain towns, and he turns around with nobody having responded and nobody's believed, even though he's done miracles in front of them. And we've got people who say, do a miracle and I'll believe. And we know that's a complete lie from the pit. And Jesus has been teaching and he's been loving and he's been doing miracles. And he turns around and there's nobody in the towns who responds to him. And he says, it would be better for you to have been in Sodom. Because the people of Sodom didn't see what you've seen. And then without any sense of being in a bad mood, he lifts up his prayer and he says, Heavenly Father, I thank you that you're completely in charge of opening eyes and hiding. You run the whole sovereign gospel ministry. And then he turns around and he says, come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden. So as my old boss used to say, if you're being a Christian witness, you're like a river down a hill. If you hit a big rock, you just move around it and keep going. You're like a vine up a fence. If you hit a beam, just keep going around it. Do not stop when you hit the rock or the beam. God is in charge. The invitation continues to go. Fourth, verse 21, you're dealing with people who don't know God. You need to remember when Jesus was dying and said, Father, forgive them. They do not know what they're doing. Now, of course, when I'm in a grumpy mood talking to a non-Christian and he's just not cooperating, I can think to myself, well, he ought to. But I have to remind myself that there is a blindness and a deadness. Of course, the unbeliever presents as if their unbelief is perfectly logical, but it's not logical. And Jesus says in verse 21, they don't know him. I remember saying to Peter Jensen once when he was the Archbishop and he was getting a lot of flack from the Sydney Morning Herald, I remember saying to him, do you find this hurtful? And he said, they don't understand. His compassion was for them. Number five, verse 22. The opposition that you've got is fighting the facts. Jesus has come. The light has come into the world. People are bicycling away from the truth. They're not bicycling toward the truth. And if you ask an agnostic if he's open or closed, which is a very good question, incidentally, you know, meet an atheist. You're not really an atheist because you don't know everything. You're an agnostic. Now, the question is, you open or closed? Well, they don't want to say closed, but they're closed. You need to be realistic. Number six, verses 23 to 24. The opposition is opposed to the Father. The opposition, as we ourselves were before we were converted, we were Genesis 3 people. We were hiding. We were not seeking. I know the television presents as if the human race is very honorable and people are really seeking and God is strangely hiding, but the Bible says that the human race is hiding and God is seeking. Number 7, verse 25. Opposition is irrational. Jesus quotes Psalm 35, where Jesus himself says, the opposition is without cause. And Jesus would say, the opposition is without cause. And we will often have to say, when we've got some opposition, it hasn't been rational. All of this is extremely helpful. No wonder we need God's help, which is why we come to chapter 15, verse 26, and we read that the counsel of the Holy Spirit will testify. And Jesus says, and you must testify. Now, I want to remind you that as Jesus has been teaching around the Last Supper, he has taught them five little seminars about the Holy Spirit, and there's a kind of a you, that is, the Holy Spirit is going to indwell you, he's going to teach you, he's going to testify through you, he's going to convict people and bring glory to Jesus. So just as the work of Jesus was a you, he left his throne, he came into the world as a man, he went down to the depths of the crucifixion, he rose again and he ascended, there is a you in the work of the Holy Spirit. He comes to take residence in the believer, teaches us, testifies through us. God in his goodness convicts people and all glory goes back to Jesus. That's what Jesus is teaching here. So my first point this morning was the hatred of the world. My second point is that Jesus prepares his disciples. My third point now is that there is mission leadership provided by the Holy Spirit. Jesus says in 15:26, the Holy Spirit is going to testify. You don't have to get him organized. You don't have to start him. You don't have to tell him. You don't have to remind him. The Holy Spirit is at work testifying. And he uses believers to testify as well. Now, of course, Jesus is especially speaking here to the original disciples. He says, you who've been with me from the beginning. And the way that the Holy Spirit works through the original disciples is that he might have prompted them to go and initiate and preach, or he might have used them to answer good questions. And that's exactly what the Holy Spirit does with believers like us. He may prompt us to go and speak to somebody, or he may tomorrow, Monday, at work, give you the opportunity to answer. And when you get to work on Monday, I would suggest that Colossians 4, 2 to 6 should be a guiding passage for you when you're at work. Colossians 4, 2 to 6, live wisely. Pray for those who've got the job of preaching. You probably don't have the job of preaching, but as you live wisely and somebody says to you, how was the weekend? You've got a golden opportunity to say something. You can say, good, end of conversation, or believe it or not, I went to a men's morning with believers from a whole lot of other churches. And believe it or not, it was great. That's all you've said. But that person knows that you have got beliefs and are fairly sane and joined other men, and that may raise another question. But this is how the Holy Spirit, he testifies using believers. He doesn't go door-to-door evangelizing on his own, if I might say this reverently. I suppose God could wake up a person who's watching television and bring them under great conviction and cause them to turn the television off and turn to their Bible and start reading it, but generally he uses human people. Generally, he speaks through other believers. And that's why Paul says in Romans chapter 10, how will they believe unless they hear? Because he'll use people like us. Now, does this verse 26, 27 apply to us when Jesus is specifically speaking to the apostles and says, you have been with me from the beginning? You know, you mustn't read yourself too quickly into verses. When you're reading your Bible and you get to 15, 26, 27, and it says, and you must testify, go on and read the rest of the verse, which says, because you've been with me from the beginning, and you'll know straight away that that specifically, primarily applies to the apostles. Somebody's done a PhD called You're So Vain, You Probably Think This Text Is About You, which I think is very clever. And you and I have got to read the Bible and see who it's primarily addressed to. But is it also addressed to us? Well, of course it is. Because the witness or the testifying, it's the same word, testify, witness, didn't stop with the apostles, but went on after the apostles and continues right up to today. And we are part of this incredibly privileged and responsible relay team to share the gospel. That's why Jesus says, I am with you to the end. They were at the beginning. He is going to be with his people right to the end. And when Jesus says, you must witness, you apostles, he doesn't say, obviously, you're the final witnesses in the world, but you're the first, you're the eyewitnesses, and after you are going to come witnesses who will point out what the eyewitnesses saw. Before we think about testifying for a few minutes, I just want you to notice that these verses about testifying, being a witness, and we're all a witness, they come wedged in between what I've just read to you about secular opposition and the first four verses of chapter 16, which are about religious opposition. Do you notice wedged in between the secular opposition and the religious opposition are two little verses which say the Spirit's at work. Now, the religious opposition in chapter 16 is very, very heated because Jesus says to the apostles, and this was very true, you need to be ready for when the Jewish leadership turns on you. And they did. Just as the secular leadership may turn on you, the religious leadership will. And the apostles had to be ready to be removed from the synagogue. And when they were removed from the synagogue, they were in very great danger because they're no longer under the umbrella of protection from the Romans. Religious opposition, as you know, is often more fanatical. Don Carson says in his commentary on John, resistance to Christ is based on imagined security. And it reaches its highest and most subversive form in religion. Read church history and see what religious church people have done to Christians. Read the news and see what religious fanatics are doing to Christians. And it all seems too much for us, which is why we would prefer to just not irritate, not get hurt, not annoy people, be friendly, be popular, except that Jesus says the Holy Spirit will testify and you must testify. And the genius behind the whole world evangelism program is God, because he has planned a salvation, Jesus has executed the salvation, the Holy Spirit is implementing, and he's going to use people like us. And because this language here is very much courtroom language, the whole of chapter 14, 15, 16 is very much courtroom language, as if we're in a big courtroom with the Holy Spirit who is prosecuting and defending. The Holy Spirit is going to call us at different times to speak. And although it is ideal if we're walking closely with Jesus, remaining, loving the believers, it's possible that he will give us opportunities above and beyond our worthiness. On Thursday, I was walking along, feeling a bit miserable, feeling quite sinful, and I walked into a secondhand shop, and a lady came up to me and she said, "Are you a teacher?" And I said, "I work as a pastor." She said, "How will I get my husband to become a Christian?" Well, I don't get those conversations every yes, I do. I get those conversations every day. No, I don't. I thought I would tell you, because it was just such an opening. It's as if the Holy Spirit, who's doing some work, says, "I can even use you." Now, I've been in that secondhand shop many times. She's a very grumpy lady. Whenever she's there, I always hope her husband is there, because he's much nicer than she is. But she was there, and she was saying, "How do I get him to become a Christian?" And I'm thinking to myself, "How do you become a Christian?" So I said, "Do you know you're going to heaven?" She said, "I hope so." I said, "If you come to the gates of heaven and Jesus says, 'Why should I welcome you into heaven?' what would you say?" And she said, "I've done my best." So I know she's not a Christian. So I started to talk to her. Half an hour later, we finished. Nobody came into the shop. It was just one of those special moments. Now, this is not in our passage in 15, but in chapter 16, Jesus says the Holy Spirit is going to bring conviction. That is, above and beyond my powers to convert or convict, the Holy Spirit can and does bring conviction. And so Jesus says he's going to cause a person to see that Jesus is central. The Holy Spirit is going to bring a person to see that sin is terrible. And the Holy Spirit is going to bring a person to see that judgment is real. That's what the Holy Spirit does. The Holy Spirit causes people to see that Jesus is higher than they thought, that sin is deeper than they thought, and judgment is closer than they thought. That's what the Holy Spirit does. I can't do it. I've talked to so many people who've just said at the end, "Thanks, but no thanks." But I've also talked to some people where the Holy Spirit has changed their hearts. That's the privilege. I wonder whether God has worked in you. Are you somebody in whom God's Spirit has persuaded you that Jesus is much bigger and better than you thought? That your sin is much more dangerous and fatal and terrible than you believed? And that judgment is much closer, hanging over you by a thread, until you call to Christ and he takes it away? Because that's the way the Holy Spirit works. Let's just think for the last few minutes about our witness to non-Christians. Tim Keller says in his last book called Making Sense of God, you know, he wrote a book called Reasons for God, which is basically answering people's questions, and he's written a book called Making Sense of God, which is asking non-Christians questions. And in the book called Making Sense of God, he says this: in the non-Western world, the growth of Christianity is stunning. Last Sunday, there were more Christians attending church in China than there were in all of Christian Europe. By 2020, Christianity will have grown from 11.4 million Christians in East Asia, 11.4 million, to 171 million. In 1910, 12 million, or 9% of Africa's population, were Christian, but they will number 630 million by 2020. In other words, it's moved from 9% to 50% in the last century. Last Sunday, I'm still reading from his book, in each of the nations of Nigeria, Kenya, Uganda, Tanzania, and South Africa, there were more Anglicans in church than there were Anglicans and Episcopalians in all of Britain and the United States combined. In each of those African countries. Now, I just say this because I just want to remind you, the Holy Spirit is at work testifying to the world, bringing the news of Christ crucified, doing the Father's plan, whether the news on our television here gets it or not. And the person who says the poor God and the poor Jesus and the poor Holy Spirit and the poor church and the poor Christians, they're doing so badly, that's like being on the Titanic and saying, I feel so sorry for those people who've got into the lifeboats. It's a nonsense. Why is there so little conviction in the West, however? Well, it could be that materialism is the opiate, drugging and dulling. It could be that there is very much a judgment from God, which we're feeling, even in the churches, even though we are spared from the judgment of God, we're feeling the judgment on the society. But the one thing we know is that it cannot be too difficult for God to save people. It cannot be too difficult. And therefore, we need to trust him and we need to obey him and we need to go on. So I want to urge you, in the light of these verses from John 15:16, keep your eternal perspective. In the end, the most important thing that we can do for people, beyond giving them food and drink and clothes and whatever, the most important thing we can do for people is get them ready for eternity. The mission of the church, which nobody else is going to do, is to get people ready for eternity by telling them about Jesus and the gift of eternal life, because in 1,000 years' time, that's really the only thing that will matter. Keep your eternal perspective. Second, do your homework so that you can share the faith. Is there anybody in this room who, if somebody turned to them at the table and just said, could you just run me through the gospel, couldn't run them through the gospel? Because if you're that person, quickly work out how you're going to share the gospel. There are so many methods. There are so many ways. Get hold of John Chapman's old book, Know and Tell the Gospel. Talk to any of the pastors. Do you remember Chapo's God Made You? You've rebelled. God has sent his son for you. What if you do, you'll be forgiven. What if you don't, you'll go to hell. God, man, God, what if you do, what if you don't? There are so many ways of explaining the gospel, but you've got to have one in your head, because when the time comes, you don't want to be stuck. Do you remember Bobby Fischer wrote a book on chess? I always remember being told this. Chapter one, how to get checkmate. Because if you don't know how to get checkmate, you're not going to start a game. And when you and I go out of here, we want to know that if something happens or we're having a chat to somebody, we can take them through the gospel quite quickly. Although the gathering of God's people is great, and some of the events that we do bring people, non-Christians, our men's dinners still work well. Not a lot of other things that we do work well. Our Christianity Explored is dwindling. Our guest services are a thing of the past. The gathering of God's people has got some limited value, but the scattering of God's people has got incredible value. And I'm so thankful that the people in the congregation where I serve leave and go places where I will never go. And if they watch their language and they seek to live kindly and they answer questions honestly and they take up openings courageously, they get to say things that I will never get to say. So be available. Say to the Lord, I'm ready. Clifford Warne, who was a member of our congregation, used to swing his legs over the side of the bed in the morning, and his opening prayer went like this: Lord, what's on today? I would like to be involved. What a great morning prayer. Lord, what is on today? I would like to be involved. I remember Mike Rater told a story once of a backsliding man who was catching an aeroplane, found himself sitting beside a little girl with obvious learning difficulties and a tough-looking businessman. And as the plane took off, after a few minutes, the little girl turned to the guy in the middle, who was a backsliding Christian, and said to him, "Do you clean your teeth?" He said, "Yes, I do." She said, "That's good, because otherwise your teeth will rot out, it will rot and fall out." Then she said, "Ask the guy on the other side if he cleans his teeth." "Excuse me, sir, the little girl wants to know if you clean your teeth." "Yes," he says, "I clean my teeth." After another half hour, the little girl turns to the guy in the middle and says to him, "Do you smoke?" And he says, "No, I don't." She says, "That's good, because otherwise your lungs will rot and you die." "Now ask the guy on the other side if he smokes." "Excuse me, sir, do you smoke?" He says, "You know, I'm trying to give it up," or something. Another half hour later, the little girl turns to the guy in the middle and says, "Do you know Jesus?" The guy thinks, "What'll I say?" So he says, "Yes, I do." She says, "Ask the guy on the other side." So she turns and says to the guy, he turns and says to the guy on the other side, "Do you know Jesus?" And the businessman puts his paper down and he says, "You know, I'm rethinking everything to do with faith in Christianity. I don't know who can answer my questions. Could you answer my questions for me?" And the little girl opened an opportunity for a backsliding Christian to share the faith with somebody who looked beyond reach. And Jesus says, the Holy Spirit is at work testifying, and you will testify. So ask him to help you and bear fruit that lasts.